Hi, welcome to the Wisdom to Wellness Show. I'm Michael McCarthy.
I'm Caroline Phipps.
I'm Louisa.
Today's show is going to be about superfoods that are very easy to cook, and every ingredient does something healthy for the body. So for today, we're going to start off with garlic steamed artichokes. And we went to Whole Foods and got some of the most perfect artichokes I think I've ever seen. It's gorgeous, isn't it?
This is a beautiful thing.
Artichokes actually are a flower bud. A artichoke plant is about 6 feet in diameter, and they just pluck the little bud out. It's very fibrous. And the interesting thing about artichokes is they cleanse the liver. So they're very good for a hangover. So if you happen to bring these as a gift to someone on a holiday meal where everyone's having a little bit too much fun, artichokes will make them feel a little bit better on the next day.
So how long does it take to cook this artichoke, Michael? Because if you have a hangover, you don't want to be spending hours in the kitchen, do you?
It's a great question. It takes about 3 hours to steam an artichoke. So the best thing to do is to steam it the day before your event. And then during the day, you can either re-steam it to warm it up or have it at room temperature. And it's also good cold. So we're going to start with this first artichoke. And at the end of every leaf, there is a little thorn that we just basically want to cut off. So just get a really good knife, because these things are pretty tough. With the rest of these, there's still a little thorn at the edge of each one. The easiest thing to do is just to slip them off with scissors. And the cool thing about artichokes is that you only get stuck once because it hurts so much.
Right.
It's true. Sometimes a little thorn will get stuck in your finger. And so we just pop them out like that. And then you just spread it. And what we're going to do is we're going to take one clove of garlic and put it into each leaf. That's the basic idea. So probably the easiest thing to do when you start with garlic is to get it pre-peeled, because if you don't have your two friends to your left and right to help you, it'll take you a long time to peel all of your garlic. And I have a quick and easy way to peel garlic.
Yeah, what do we do that makes this easy?
If you don't have any materials, you just take the heel of your palm, mush it, and you're done. That's it. And you can just peel it off. Let me give it a shot. How'd it go?
I'm gonna use my knife.
Alright. So we just take
I think you have to be a strong man to do that.
Thank you for that. So then you just take your piece. If you get a whole piece, just cut it. This one's been a little bit mushed. And then you just start spreading it around.
It looks so beautiful, doesn't it? You know,
it's very pretty, yeah.
It's a really beautiful thing.
And the history of artichokes is pretty cool. Even though they're really good for cleansing the liver and curing a hangover, they actually have been around since the 16th century?
Yeah, I believe they have a fairly illustrious history. I'm told that it was thought that if you ate artichokes, you would only have boy babies. And in Europe, that was a pretty significant thing among the aristocracy, because you needed to produce an heir and a spare.
What's the spare?
The spare is the second in line to the throne or to the family fortune.
Oh, in case the first one didn't...
In case the first one doesn't make it.
Oh, wow. I wonder how that worked out.
Yeah. I think it probably worked out quite well. It was a very important thing in the 16th century.
It was if you wanted to keep being married to King Henry.
Yeah, exactly. I know.
Literally produce.
Yeah, I think poor Anne Boleyn obviously didn't get her hands on any artichokes, did she?
I don't think she... Yeah, I think she was an omnivore.
I think so.
A little bit too much steak. Okay.
So when we've stuffed this with the garlic, mm-hmm. then what do we do?
So this is basically your stuffed artichoke. And what happens with the garlic is it gets sweeter as it cooks. And the heart-healthy benefits of garlic staying intact even when you cook it, unless you microwave it. Once you microwave garlic, then all the health properties go away. When garlic is raw, it's going to keep its antibacterial properties for you, but once you cook it, that will go away, but the heart-healthy part stays.
Right, so it's very good for your circulation, so that's why it's good for heart, I think.
It is, and if Louisa, if you could pass me that pot. and we'll show. This is a nifty little tool that you can get from a cooking store. It's an artichoke holder. So you basically just put it in like that. Or if you have a steamer at home, cut the stem off and then it will just sit flat. So basically it's just gonna go in like this. And if you pass me the olive oil and the sea salt, what we'll also do, I like smoked sea salt, which actually kind of tastes and smells like a campfire. You can also use pink Himalayan salt or any sea salt that you like. Oh,
yeah,
try
this
it.
Is amazing.
Just have a little taste.
I love it. I just never thought to use it.
So we just pour it over.
Yeah, this is amazing. It's like campfire in a jar.
It is. It feels like you're outdoors.
Yeah, it really does.
So you just fill this up with water up to the point. You can fill it up pretty much to this area here. And again, you're going to be cooking this for about 3 hours. So you just keep filling it back up with water until it's done. It's almost impossible to overcook an artichoke. And once you're finished, the final product is going to look just like this. So it blooms a little bit, and when you take them out, thanks, Lisa. When you take them out, you just scoop up a little piece of garlic, which is pretty sweet, and you don't eat the whole leaf. That's actually, when my mother was dating my father, she was English and German, and he was Italian. So at the feast, they gave my mother an artichoke. That was sort of the test of, you know, should my mother marry my father? And so my mother ate the leaf and just cringed, and they thought it was really funny and said, you can go marry your husband now.
Are they still together now?
Almost 50 years.
Well, yeah, there you go.
Almost 50 years. So what you do is, this is the meaty part.
And they had a boy.
You're right. It's true. See, it works. It's true. I'm living proof, literally. So all you do is you just scrape this on the bottom row of your teeth.
Yum.
It's delicious.
Yum.
You can try one.
How wonderful. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I like them at room temperature. And they're just absolutely delicious.
Mm.
And the fun part is there's a prize at the end of the artichoke, which is called the artichoke heart.
This is true.
And what we'll do, I'm going to show you how to get to the artichoke heart. So I'm going to take these leaves off. So all these leaves are great to eat. And I'm pretty generous with the garlic, because I love garlic. And if you worry about how your breath smells to friends, just make sure that they eat the same food along with you. And then you kind of match.
Now, whenever I'm eating an artichoke in a restaurant, I'm always worried about making sure that the heart at the end is the piece that you're meant to eat the whole piece of, because I've ended up with a mouthful of the bit that you don't want before now, and then you kind of have to pretend that you're eating it, because you know that you're meant to know where the beginning and end of this thing is.
So we'll just show you where the best parts are. So as you start to peel it out, you start to see this little hairy parts, and all you do is you just lightly pluck them out like that.
Okay, so you don't want the hairy part.
No, you don't want the hairy part. And you, again, this, the artichokes are like, again, you only make a mistake once. So
yeah, you really
the hair,
do.
Yeah, you kind of know there's something unnatural.
Yeah, it's
about
like
this.
Having a, you know, dicing with a porcupine. It's a bad scene.
It's not working for you.
Yeah, that is fantastic.
So the stalk was there. So you go from the stalk to the heart right here.
So this is all good.
This is like the filet mignon of an artichoke.
Thank you.
So tons of fiber.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
Oh, that is so good.
Cheers.
Chin
Cheers.
Chin.
Chin chin.
Mm.
So, this was our first dish. Pretty easy. So our next dish is going to be an incredibly simple dessert. And again, we're going to be using superfood ingredients. What we do is that we're just going to take an orange, split it in half, and we're going to rub it in cinnamon.
Now, the thing is, Michael, I don't like cinnamon. And I'm wondering if maybe I'm the only person in the entire United States of America. But I have a feeling that you, if anybody's going to make me like cinnamon, it's going to be you.
You have to like it because it's a TV show.
Oh, so sorry.
We have to get along.
Okay. Roll it out, baby.
So all we're going to do, we just peel a orange like this. Clementines are great because they're tiny and they end up being really great finger food. Just at the end of the meal when everyone's just sort of sitting around having some wine or what have you.
They're actually
seedless too, right?
They're easier in a way than oranges too, aren't they?
These are seedless. Perfect.
How lovely is that?
So oranges kind of have a bit of a interesting history. They're about 2500 BC, they came from?
Yes, I believe that they originated in China, and they were first known as the Chinese apple.
Nice. Well, they kind of look like a bit of an apple.
I suppose they do. If you only got apple as a reference, then
yeah, exactly.
Maybe they would.
So all we're going to do now is just rub these in cinnamon. Caroline, could you hand me the cinnamon over there? Right there.
Okay.
So what we do, the reason that we like to use oranges is they're actually a very good laxative because they have a... They also make you laugh, too, you know? How are you in third grade? Yeah, it all worked out, right? Back in the room for you? Yeah, got it. Okay. So everyone knows about the vitamin C, but the pectin, which is basically like the little white parts here, will act as a laxative and it helps you with losing weight. So what we do is we just simply bisect the orange, and on the opposite side, this white part is the pectin. This is where the fiber is. And Louisa, if you wouldn't mind helping me out and peel the larger one. So now what we do is we just put some cassia cinnamon in the bottom of the bowl and just rub it in like this. Nice and simple. And it comes out like that. And
well, it looks beautiful, Michael.
It is pretty. And so here's our final version. And the interesting thing about cinnamon is actually the bark of a tree. It came from the evergreen tree. Now they use the cassia tree.
Right.
And cassia cinnamon is the only cinnamon that acts as a natural insulin regulator. So when people end up getting diagnosed with diabetes, doctors, when they try to help you out on the nutrition side, will tell you to have as much cinnamon as possible. The Saigon or Vietnamese cinnamon does not have the natural insulin regulation. You just want the cassia. And if you look at the scrolled cinnamon, what ends up happening is that when they go to the tree, at the upper branches, they'll take the little piece of bark off, and that little piece of bark will then roll into a scroll. At the bottom of the tree is the larger, heavier bark. And when they take that off, they grind it, and that's where our ground cinnamon comes from.
I have a little secret for you.
Yeah?
It tastes like ground bark to me.
You know?
So what are we going to do?
Well, I think we need to see if you like it, because the sweetness in the orange...
So you think this might change everything? For all those people out there like me who aren't so keen on cinnamon, this could be the moment.
You could be the ultimate taste test.
I really could. Okay.
And be honest.
Here we go.
So we're starting with bark.
We're starting with bark. That's what...
Cheers.
Cha-ching. Well, it makes you laugh. Like
good.
It's surprisingly good, isn't it?
Mm.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to sound surprised.
Well, I was surprised when I found it. I was just studying, I was reading about cinnamon, and I had an orange on the table, and I just ground it in there, and I thought, well, maybe this will work.
You invented this?
Yeah, I just was sitting there with cinnamon one day, and there was an orange, and I just ground it in there, and I surprised myself. Well, you know, sometimes you win.
Did we hear that cinnamon has an hallucinogenic quality to it?
Would you be our resident expert to share with us the...
Only if it's taken in vast quantities.
How vast?
That I don't know. But it was considered a hallucinogenic, or is considered hallucinogenic, but I think you have to take it with a wheelbarrow.
I know you
so
can...
So it's not recommended.
It might be too much for a human, because I know there's enough... If you eat 25 pounds of chocolate, you can get an opium high, but you're going to have a hard time getting that much in there. You're better off going to other sources.
I could probably eat 25 pounds of chocolate, but a wheelbarrow full of cinnamon, not so much.
A little bit much.
But you've really made it good for me, because...
I'm glad you like it. So yeah, this is just, you know, nice, simple, and easy. So that's dessert.
Thank you, Michael.
Mm-hmm. Bravo.
So our next dish is going to be a beet cilantro salad, that's going to have a little bit of a twist on it. One is going to be with sherry vinaigrette, and the other is going to be sherry vinaigrette with a grainy mustard.
Yum, love mustard.
You do like your mustard.
I do, yes I do.
So again, it's another easy dish, pretty fast to do. And what we do is we're going to start with the beet.
Now I've always found all of this rather daunting. You know, all this stuff on the end and this thing and everything, so.
You know, it's funny, there's more nutrition in the beet leaf than there is in the beet itself.
And it's delicious. You just chop it up, clean it, chop it, and saute it with a little garlic and olive oil, and it's delicious.
So it's almost like you can do it like you would with the collard greens.
Absolutely.
Oh, how wonderful. Those colors are fantastic.
Sea salt. I love smoked sea salt.
Mm.
So all you do is you cut it like this.
Okay.
And if I can have a piece of tin foil.
Sure.
You just wash it. And then you're going to tent it so it's going to have a little bit of air.
Now, why does it need air in it?
Oh, just so it can circulate and kind of steam.
Okay.
So it
cooks quicker, it probably.
Does. So you're going to put this in the oven on 400 for 25 minutes. And all you have to do when you're done to test it, if they're small, it'll take about 20 minutes. If they're large, like this size, you might be looking at something in the area of 45 minutes. But all you do is just take a knife, as long as it goes through kind of like butter, then you're pretty much finished. Again, beets are like artichokes, it's very hard to overcook them. Now once they come out, just put them in the refrigerator for about a half an hour. And
so straight from the oven into the refrigerator?
Yes.
Okay.
And what we're gonna do is, by making them cold, it makes them easy to peel.
Oh,
so
clever.
This is your cooked beet here. And all you do
so
is...
So that has the skin on it at the moment?
This is the skin right here, yeah.
Oh, look at that, amazing.
It just slides right off.
Wow. It just slops right off.
Gorgeous.
It's kind of like when you're peeling a hard-boiled egg.
Yeah, truly. Oh, that looks wonderful.
It's easier. It is easier.
Mm.
So all you do is you just peel it.
Okay.
Like this. The interesting thing about beets is pharmaceutical companies use parts of the beet for anti-anxiety and anti-depression medicine. Because beets will actually produce dopamine and serotonin, which makes you happy. So you'll see they're very soft, and they stain pretty quickly, so you want to make sure that you clean up afterwards, otherwise you're going to have purple fingers for about a week. And so I want to have some pretty color in here, so we're going to have some red beets and some orange beets.
And the orange beets, do you cook them in the same way?
Yes, we have the orange brother right here. Lisa, can I have that one?
Yeah.
So we're basically going to do the same thing. It looks a little green, even though it's not. And
look at that. That's the most wonderful color.
It's pretty. It's very nice. And these are root vegetables, which basically means they'll also have a calming effect on you.
Yes, yeah, so it's that whole idea of feeling rooted.
And very grounded.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. And it does give you that feeling. You will also notice that when you go to the bathroom that it's going to be purple. And some people...
No.
Yeah, yeah. So I actually...
You mean your pee is going to be purple?
No, the other. The other.
Oh.
The only reason I found out, I was at a party in Toronto and they had a beet salad. And a friend of mine is rather scientific. And he brought himself to the emergency room the next morning. And
oh, no.
He thought he was bleeding.
Goodness
so
me.
What he ended up doing was went to the emergency room, and they basically said, well, you ate some beets. So he came back to the apartment, told us what happened, and I had a can of beets. And I said, why are you eating the beets? And he said, I want to replicate
what happened
and make sure the doctor was right. So I didn't hear the end of that story, but I assume everything worked out.
So now what are you going to put with these beautiful things?
Now what we're going to do is we're going to marinate them. So
Caroline,
I can have some white vinegar.
Okay.
So you're going to take equal parts of white vinegar and sherry. So if you take a look at just how many beets you have in there, you just put a little bit to kind of get them wet so that you can stir them around. You really can't put in too much. So just...
Okay.
And then this.
So what is this?
This is sherry.
Mmm.
Yum.
Yum.
So this is a very easy way to make sherry vinaigrette. And again, it's just equal portions. And you could have a little aperitif in your in your cocktail.
It smells good.
It does smell good, doesn't it? So we'll move that over here. Then we're going to put in sugar, and just a little bit. You only want to give it like a dusting like that. The whole point of the sugar is to pull out the flavor, and you'll also pull some, get some moisture out. And that's the same reason why we put in a dusting of smoked sea salt. Again, any old sea salt will do. I prefer to use sea salt just because it's better for you. I also like the taste.
Well, sea salt has got a great array of minerals in, right, that we really need. So any salt that's got a really good color to it, it's usually indicative of having minerals in it.
Pink Himalayan sea salt's also a good one. So now what we can do...
So what are we going to do with this now? It looks delicious already.
All you do is you just stir this up. You can put this in the fridge overnight. You can have it right away, but it's better if it marinates. So that's version one. Version two is to put in some stone ground mustard.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So any mustard that you like, I prefer the ones that have like the little seeds in them.
Yeah, me too. I love that.
So you just give this one a little squeeze. And what you're doing with the mustard is you're going to give it a little bit of a snap, and it gets creamy. So just like Julia Child, you can just use your hands if you like. And you just mix it up.
These colors are amazing.
Yeah, and colors, interestingly enough, antioxidants are the colors of food. So when you see all these different colors, the yellow, the orange, the green, you're actually getting different antioxidants. Just give it a mix only to get it wet, and all this liquid is just going to be marinating with it. And at the same time, we're going to put in some cilantro. You can also use parsley. What I like to use cilantro for is it has a really nice taste to it. It adds beautiful color. And instead of chopping, I just take scissors. It's much easier.
Yeah, scissors are good, aren't they?
The cool thing about cilantro is it helps remove heavy metals from the body. So if you have mercury fillings from the dentist, and usually with age they're going to start leaking, this will help get them out of the body. Also, cilantro and parsley are diuretics.
It smells delicious.
It's nice, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Parsley and cilantro are both diuretics, so they'll help lower your blood pressure. And this is basically how we're going to go into the refrigerator, and our final product, when we're done, it's going to look just like this. And I like to put a little spray of lemon juice on it, and it gives it like a nice little snap. And this is our grainy mustard. If there are people that don't like cilantro, some people have a special enzyme where cilantro tastes like tar. So if you're having guests, I suggest just using parsley instead.
Yeah, you know, they always ask to check with people about cilantro because people either love it or they really, really can't bear it. And maybe that's for that very reason.
And we want everyone to love your food.
We do.
Can
we have some?
You can try some, absolutely. Mm. You just need a spoon now. Or you can use your fingers, like Julia. It's good, isn't it?
This is really good.
I like the mustard one the best.
It's absolutely delicious.
Remember, you have to clean your fingers. But this is really tasty. Super good for you. Yeah, it doesn't. What we like about our food is it doesn't taste healthy.
Oh, it's really good.
Glad you like it.
Yeah, the flavors are wonderful.
So now we're going to be off to our next dish. So our next dish is going to be a chocolate mousse, but it's healthy for you.
Oh, divine.
It's raw, it's vegan, and it has avocados in it, believe it or not. The avocado is where we get the creaminess, and we just mix that with cacao and a few other ingredients. So what we start with is an avocado. And what's interesting about avocado is that it has always had a reputation for being an aphrodisiac. And avocado derives from the Spanish word testicle, which is why it comes with the aphrodisiac. You always laughed in class, didn't you? Yeah, this never really quite grew up. That's okay. It's why we like you on the show. You had a little levity to it all. So basically, you just cut this right down the middle and so, give it, yes?
Sorry, I was going to say, apart from being an aphrodisiac,
yeah.
Avocados are actually really good for us, aren't they?
They have a lot of the good fat, monounsaturated, and monounsaturated actually lowers cardiac risk, and polyunsaturated does the same thing. Saturated fat raises it a little bit, not as bad as its reputation.
Right.
It really gets knocked around a little bit too much. The really bad one is trans fat. Molecularly, it's one molecule away from a plastic, which is why it clogs the veins. In fact, you're kind of embalming yourself slowly.
That's not good. I'd like to stick...
Do you pick that for you?
Yes, and show everyone how fun it is to get that out. You just whack it with a knife, pop it out, and then all you do is just scoop this out like this, and we pop it into your little blender. Any blender will do, stronger the better.
So for people who aren't so keen on vegetables, an avocado is actually a fruit, I think.
Aren't you smart? You studied this, didn't you?
I did.
You know what you're talking about.
Yes.
It is. It's actually a fruit, the fertility fruit.
We're all supposed to know this from IIN, right?
Yes, we all went to the Institute for Integrative Nutrition, our nutrition school, which is where we all met. And so we're all pretty much on the same page with superfoods. I just happen to like everything that tastes really good. So now we take our one avocado goes in.
Okay.
Then you're going to take 1 cup of almond milk. You can also use hemp milk if you want to get a full spectrum of protein.
Or rice milk? Could you use rice milk? Have you ever done that?
I haven't used rice milk. As long as you get a little bit of a nutty flavor, because the almond and the hemp seed will also have a little bit of nuttiness.
Okay.
And these are pitted dates. You want to soak these for about an hour in water so they get nice and soft. Manjul dates actually taste the best. And so once you soak them, you only want about 2/3 of a cup. They look a little bit waterlogged, which is what you want to get the sweetness out. So you just pop those little guys in there.
Yeah.
Then we're going to take our cacao and hand that over to me.
Okay.
And so we're going to take not that much of it, actually, just about a half a cup of pure raw cacao powder, which when you taste it, it's a little rough because there's no sugar.
It's a bit rough, right?
It's a little rough, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. And then we're going to take a little bit of almond butter. Could I have that?
Okay.
There we go. So just 1/4 cup, not that much. That's also going to add to our thickness and our creaminess.
These are some of my favorite things going in here, Michael.
Well, you know what's funny? The raw folks and the vegans have very little to choose from when you compare to omnivores.
Right.
And this is perfect. I mean, what's funny, I chose this because you can't tell that it's not chocolate mousse. It's amazing. So we just pop that in there.
I don't think, generally, people would think about putting avocado with chocolate, would they?
I thought it was really strange. Mm-hmm. It's called mock chocolate mousse.
But yeah.
The texture comes out so creamy.
Mm-hmm. And then some options you can do, if you want to put in a little bit of vanilla, that's one thing you can try. Or not, it doesn't really matter one way or the other. It depends on whether you like vanilla. Madagascar is the strongest and the best. Then you can also do a little bit of maple syrup, and there are different grades. Grade A is the amber, the lighter, which is what this is. However, the grade B has more flavor and is cheaper.
Oh, is that right?
It's just way back in the 1800s, people thought things that were lighter, like white bread over dark bread, were better. But actually, if you want the flavor, just get the dark maple syrup. So now we're going to use my favorite machine, the Vitamix, which I think is everyone's favorite machine when you go to nutrition school. The motor in here, incredibly strong. This machine would last probably 30, 40 years. It's really industrial strength. And this is your little jammer when you have some harder pieces that kind of allows you to stir it around. So we're going to put it on low, and we just want to mix it up a little bit. It gets a little loud, it's fast. This, as you can see, took about 5 seconds to do. So if you care to put your little finger in there, try that one. Madam? Absolutely, you can have a whole spoon. Yeah.
Oh, that's a beautiful thing.
Isn't that good?
God, that's delicious.
You can't tell, you'd never think this was an avocado.
You would never think it's an avocado, and it's so chocolatey.
Here, we have some more.
It's very good. And nice and healthy for you. And you can have as much of this as you want. So, your friends will love you.
And chocolate's an aphrodisiac too, right?
Actually, Montezuma drank 50 cups of
chocolate
cocoa Every day.
Because?
He had 200 wives. He had a lot.
It's big love gone wild.
It's definitely big love gone wild. So when you have chocolate, it's actually a blood thinner, so it helps with memory.
Goodness me, how wonderful.
And it's also one of the highest antioxidant foods known to man. As long as you get above 60% cacao,
right.
And this is 100% cocoa powder. Mm-hmm. So it's about as good as it gets.
Hey, they use this stuff for money. It was currency.
I think this could be currency. I could barter with this. Social currency. Well, thanks for joining us today, and we hope you enjoy the recipes, and please go to the grocery store and try them out. They're nice, quick, and easy. Thank you.
Fabulous eats and sumptuous treats.
There you go. Thank you for joining us, Lisa.
Thank you, Michael.
Bye-bye.